everybody else. It was my suggestion on some of these specific items of long-range study, particularly that we do break up into committees to research these things. Because collectively, we don't have enough time to do it, but it's certainly not one that I'm going to argue about, because we can still do it without ad hoc committees. We have only one standing committee that I know of, a small one. And I don't particularly personally don't like the way it functions, because it revolves around one individual, and that's on our legislature. I think more people should be involved in making some decisions as to what should come back to the council on recommendation.
One of the first coming to the committee. Yeah. Just as a, if we do have anything else, regardless of what the business is, I think it's one speaking. Because there's so much information available within the staff that no committee be constituted without having someone from the staff, and that could be the manager's office at least, and maybe most instances from the attorney's office, because we might be going clear off on a tangent, or searching up information when they've got it. They've got a tremendous amount of information. I would say staff, which would include all of the city managers, and or the attorney or planning director.
I run into another question that goes through my mind on committee. What happens? You assign an attorney, you assign a staff to the committee, and the committee, a long-running committee, I mean, sometimes they've got some very important things, other times probably a lot of nothing. But with this, if we authorize, as suggested by Ivers, is this an open the door threat to me? For example, let's get the attorney staff on this. My God, you might tie four or five of their people up on something. You might do the same thing with management. So there, it isn't an automatic, okay, now you've got this over here and you go in all directions, I would think. If it's anything other than a normal level of service, maybe we ought to just about budget this thing, because there are some values that have to be established on this thing.
I think this is when a committee should come back to the council, just like you have today. And there are more than the one committee. There's the Transit Committee, with Harry and Jack.
I said one standing
committee. Okay. Harry and Jack are members of the ad hoc committee. But they've come back with a recommendation that we study set out a contract for an actuarial study on the retirement for the council workers. Well, this kind of thing comes back to us. This is proper taking.
I know the reason why you recommend that to Hunter is probably like all of us. We feel that there's some major problems, long-standing problems, that they necessarily aren't coming back to the council or getting the attention, like water, for one, the legislative recommendations and so on. And I'm wondering if, following up on Ivor's suggestion, if we didn't establish areas, long-standing areas that the council as a whole is interested in, and then give this responsibility to the manager, and he can assign someone from his staff and so on, and that we would expect quarterly reports in these areas. Like, when was the last time we sat down to discuss water? It's been a year and a half, probably. And it's an important enough question.
This is one, Jack, that worries me, because I had a meeting in the office the other day with our representatives on the County Water Authority. It's the first time in 8 years that anybody's ever sat down and talked to them. Nobody's fault, except we just don't have time to get around to all these things. And there should be some liaison set up. That's my personal thing.
Well, my feeling on Ivor's suggestion is that he was talking about probably with all of the committees and all of the work we do have, that for one of us to be assigned to a committee, two of us to be assigned to a committee, really all we're doing is then just asking the manager's people to do the groundwork and get it together. And I think if we turned over the responsibility of certain areas and said as a council, we want quarterly or semi-annual reports in these areas, and increase the reports as a problem. Like, there's a number of us that are interested in reclamation, but we're running in different directions trying to find things out. The manager, you find out, has a whole bunch of information that's been coming in. Water, the whole question of water is another problem. Rapid transit as opposed to our immediate transit needs is a problem. And I think you're right. We haven't given the proper emphasis into demanding these things back. I think, though, if we break it down to council committees, I think it's a mistake, as we've learned from, say, from the legislative committee. And undertake these responsibilities in these areas, and that we expect quarterly, semi-annual, or somewhat reports or presentations on it.
Couldn't we have accomplished almost the same thing? Rather than have council committees constituted as councilmen, have a councilman assigned to a particular area. Now, one councilman is assigned to civil defense. Now, I had it for a couple of years, and I think Alan's had it for a couple of years, with an alternate. One councilman assigned to water, and with an alternate probably, and attend the meetings with our commissioners. So when we come up with a discussion of water, somebody in the council, he's not speaking for the council, but he has been there and attended the meetings on water. Just like we do in civil defense, so that we have somewhat of an authority in an elected official. He hasn't spoken for the council necessarily, but at least you're there at the meetings, and that would appear to be better than making up a council committee to represent the council.
I've noticed on these committees too that the meetings happen to fall. I run into the situation where we've got the border area study, which I was on, the civilian defense and the campaign, the whole package. Let's say they don't get this.
So with this, poverty too.
Yeah, and with this, what are we accomplishing now? On the Sandy Sarvey thing, at least we have a staff alternate, and by golly, they will be there. You know, it's nice to go there when you can and get there, but you hate to see the thing dissolve and dilute. We've got quite a few council appointments to committees right now, and you end up taking your time, and I think we should establish a priority on our time, because we got a, you know, a dog catcher committee where I still take as much time as if it's on rapid transit of water.
Another one is industrial development.
It's an area where we need a lot of labor.
Yeah, but if we had a councilman, again, assigned to that, rather than have a council committee constituted, because we have enough people working on that if we would only have a liaison.
This was the intent behind this idea of having, breaking up into groups of three, then you've got a backup for the guy that can't make the meeting.
That's so darn many things to do. I mean, you take all the important things that you've got, put everybody on a committee and take two council days, and then take about two important committees apiece, and you're not going to have time to breathe.
I agree with you.
I don't have time to get through my mail. I mean, look what you've got with all the staff you have and the trouble you have getting organized and this stuff. What do you think we're going to have?
Very, I agree with you. But it's just that much more difficult to get the whole council collected together for a series of the same kind of meeting.
I wanted to ask, Your Honor,
mm-hmm.
What is the alternate to this if we do not have councilmen on committees? What do you have to do? Go to citizens' committees?
Well, I don't know. Whatever, I'm going to do whatever is necessary to keep up liaison on these various problems. I don't know what it's going to be, but
okay.
This is a suggestion that the council
What do you do yourself, Frank, to keep abreast of these? You send a staff member, don't you?
No, I do not.
Well, every time I go someplace, you aren't there, and you're...
Well,
you have
if I'm not
there, your office there.
Right. But in the bulk of these, I go myself. Or try to.
Well, we're going to have, Your Honor, we're going to have some other things coming up, such as the 200th anniversary, which will be a real important thing. Some councilmen probably should, I would think, be assigned to that.
Well, here again, if the council doesn't like this concept... It's one suggestion. The other, of course, is the appointment of ad hoc committees by the council or by the mayor or by staff to take care of specific problems.
Well, 200th anniversary is more of an ad hoc type of thing, I would think, because it's not going to go on forever.
Well, I really hate to see us get into the position of appointing committees to coordinate committees to follow up on other committees. And I think if we find ourselves in that. We might find ourselves in that position. I would rather, if anything, just have either the manager have an assignment of the areas or take councilmen and have them basically somewhat formed. Doesn't mean that they have to attend all of the meetings, but just to occasionally show up to show that we are interested in some.
Exactly what I suggest, Jack.
Is just assignment of areas and not committees?
Right.
If there are areas where we are represented in, an area like civil defense, that's not a council committee. If it worked like that, I would say very
well. Well, you know, we all have in our own various districts too certain things that are happening. like this mid-city thing.
City plan.
I want to see this thing work. I know Alan does now. With this, there are meetings of the Mid-City Development Board with our city staff, and it's quite surprising the things that I get back by calling the chairman of the thing and finding out what's going on, and also finding that there are tools that they are not using or leverages that they're not using to bring these things about. So you add these committees, specialized problems from your district, and these things start getting pretty heavy.
It's a full-time situation.
Yeah, who can afford it?
Well,
worse than doing it now, so I mean,
it's, yeah, it's
so now we do some more. We're up to our ears. Will you keep your filthy hands off of my equipment, please? The lie detector guy.
He's going to use his council meeting to shine in the mayor's eye when he wants his attention to speak.
Well, let's not just drop it. Let's why don't we just decide on if there is an area of agreement here so that we can resolve it. As a group, is anybody in favor of establishing committees of councilmen for these areas? I, for one, am opposed, so we could drop that area and go on to other possibilities.
The thing I'm concerned with is the system. And I'm not talking about committees. I mean, we've got a problem, and so we're trying to find an answer to solve it, I think. I mean, the committee was a suggestion. We also have a small committee that's been figuring out the procedures for conducting meetings, et cetera. But, I mean, we've got this whole problem of paperwork running in and running out and expediting it so that we put our time where it's going to do the most good, and that's the answer that I would like to get to. You can go out in your office once in a while, you pull out that big monster file cabinet you have, and when you schedule to throw 90% of that junk away. And we all have this problem, and it has to get done. This is part of the problem.
It was actually a suggestion. This idea was a suggestion following what we had presented. For instance, done previously with one individual rather than three, because we didn't have any backup. Now we have enough constantly. But going back to the old days, for instance, when I'll take George Perry. George was the council's informant on water, period. That was his interest and his concern, and he just dedicated himself to finding out all there was about the water problem so that he could keep the council informed. And that was our source of information, because the council collectively couldn't sit down and go through all the materials and all the meetings and all the other things that George went through as an interest in himself. It was a suggestion to keep the council informed as far as possible by developing some research in these areas.
Because we have a 9-member council, it doesn't mean that we have enough work to do. There are two more people.
Anything, it's more.
Two more people need to talk and need to be heard, and we still have to be informed on those many things.
That was the thought behind it. Again, we never always used to agree with George just because he came in with some information, but 99% of the time we did because he had the information and built and did the research and did these kind of things.
We had a committee on building rights one time, inspection rates, and we didn't necessarily agree with it.
Yeah, that was...
Mr. Big
Never again!
Yeah.
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 He was really upset, so we didn't do exactly what we wanted to.
this is there are some things, you know. I know John Leppard. John told me he was afraid it would fall down into government by committee, and that was not my intention. But if there's any qualms on the part of the council, forget it. Well, attempt to develop more information for the council without everybody having to attend all the meetings.
Well, then, Your Honor, it would be necessary then if we're not going to adopt this council committee idea. Then we'd have to have any presentation made to the entire council, like in these conferences. Wouldn't that be the other route?
Well, I think you're trying to define it down to some specifics that can't be accomplished. For instance, following this idea that we get manager to give us reports. If he gave us a report on every meeting that went on in relation to the outside activities that are going on that are indirectly or directly related to the council, we'd spend all our time getting reports.
Well, I can't read what I'm getting now.
What's wrong?
And then some good citizen sends in a report, two or three or four, a few pages to read.
Does seem to me, though, Mr. Mayor, that we perhaps should give on some regular basis reports to council on some of the major areas of operation, such as this water reclamation, all the other things that we are working on a long-standing basis.
We used to have a manager's report, which wasn't a particular thing that I ever had in mind, but, you know, you can get a Kiplinger's letter, and you can tell pretty well what's going on in the country with a couple of pages, yet we seem capable of putting together something like that for circulation. So we can, I mean, just touching on the various areas that we know they're going on, and if we want more detail, we can dive into it.
I went back and took a file out of Charlie's old file, and we're used to make these periodic reports to the council of items, not specific items in front of us, but items out of magazines and digests sort of thing. We had some, I think Phil used to do one, and Pat did it for a while. Digest, calling your attention to specific items that could be read, and reports. And that bogged down for the same reason that these reports bogged down. You just get your damn much paper.
Well, if you could get one report, I mean, even if you take Fortune magazine, you open the page and you find that all the subjects are there, and a smattering of what goes on. You grab what you want out of it. I'm not saying a big thick document, but it would seem to me we get these these various magazines that we subscribe to.
Charlie used to do a one-page summary of the specific
This is what I would like to see, because we all get a certain amount, and I call it garbage, because if it fills your desk and you don't have time to use it, it's garbage. And it even takes time away from that which you should be putting your time at. If there's some way of something that I can read a couple of pages a week that tell us where we are, what's going on, and so forth, and areas that we're getting into, it would stimulate more important conversation out of it. I think it's that fear of not knowing what's going on that bothers me more than anything else. I know I don't.
What concerns me, and I was hoping you'd get me.
I suggest the manager go into a data retrieval system, which would give us the information we need.
But how do you know what the point is? How do you know what we need?
You've got to set up a data processing.
Just send it in.
It's not data processing.
Well, it's the data receiving.
Right.
Phase of data processing.
Simply coding it in such a way you know what, where, and how to retrieve it. Doesn't require any data.
So you have processing. You have an index?
You have an indices that will give you information.
Well, I would suggest the council just file it down and bring it up occasionally as the specific item comes up.
I would say that the council would go on record that we enlarge upon our present plan of appointing specific a complement to specific areas of interest, such as water reclamation, water, civil defense, and so on, as needed, and that any other committees that the complement serves on are specifically ad hoc committees. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I went to me.
Okay. I still would like to have some suggestions coming up now. We heard about Charlie Dale's report. I'm talking about the Kipling's letter type of thing. Now, I still find no great enthusiasm here, but I still find a big raft of paper, and I want to find all a suggestion on how to get out of it.
I can tell you why you don't find enthusiasm. I've tried three or four times in the last couple of months to put one of these things together to try it. Summary, but by the time you read it yourself or get somebody to research it for you and get it digested and get it together, it's anti-dated to the point where it really isn't current. unless we got somebody assigned to it, and that's pretty damn difficult because, for instance, every time we talk about anything, we say, oh, let the manager go ahead and do this. So you give it to somebody in management, you give it to one of the staff people. What the heck is he going to digest? What might interest you may not interest me.
Mr. Kiplinger doesn't call me up and ask what interests me. He prints that which is of national interest. I want something coming out of council interest. The things that we're concerned in. Now, I know it can be done.
That's right.
Mayor, let me say this. We certainly want to have the format of the reports to council. I mean, what you want, we'll design them any way you want them. We we have found when we try to summarize material, but we then are immediately requested for a good deal of additional information, which we then have to get out a 3 or 4 page report on.
This kind of thing is real good because it's based on what is the
I'm not talking about these reports here that come out when the manager wants to put them out. I'm talking about water. I'm talking about mass transit. I'm talking about all the stuff that comes in. Where are we? What's going on? You know.
That's why I suggested that quarterly reports on areas of interest. Maybe a 10-minute presentation. The first presentation may be a half hour, like on water. There's a lot of things I don't know about water I would look at.
You're not going to find it, no 10-minute presentation once a quarter, I'll tell you for sure. This is a thing you got to live with. That's why I suggested the council designated someone who has a specific interest in this to follow these things. Go to meetings when they pop up. Go to the study that the material comes through. You get reports from the state and federal government. Southwest Water Plan alone. I think there's probably 5 pages of material a day comes through on that darn thing, and not a single person, including staff, has an opportunity to sit down and digest this stuff.
Well, if staff doesn't have an opportunity, well, I sure as hell am not going to have an opportunity. This is the problem. This is why I say turn assign it to a staff individual in an area of responsibility, because the decision is going to be made by all. I seriously...
Staff knowing the answer, Jack, doesn't help me a bit. It might help you, but it sure don't help me.
You ought to call them. That's pretty good.
Well, that's another problem. The committee's the one that calls staff all the time. Also confuses the issue because the rest of the council's not appraised of what's going on. This is why I think in specifics we should have some backup.
We have talked about this off and on for the last, I guess, 7 years that I've been close up to city to know. And, I talked again at a conference not too long ago with a couple people from State College. I have now 2 letters on my desk, one from Dr. Beavers and one from, I've forgotten. Anyway, going back to reevaluate the young man that from State College that Jack had, when we were talking about this, his effectiveness, and State College would very much like a program of this kind where they would get their solid-eyed majors in, or, you know, at the senior level or working for masters in a work-type situation. Now, this, to me, is an area where these persons could be invaluable by doing this kind of gathering for the councilmen. It would relieve staff of a lot of the obligation. It would give the feeling and the knowledge to the individual concerned. What is he here 2 days a week or portions of 2 days?
20 hours a week.
20 hours a week. This would give, to me, real value to us for missing this individual. I think it would be valuable to the individual. Dr. Biggers has asked if we could sit down and discuss this to see if we can, with the city, the State College should work out a program of these interns, and this may be an excellent way to.
Of course, it's possible they can take up more time about staff digging out information if the staff dug it out in the first place.
Well, this is a thing that has to be considered.
I mean, these people are pretty green, and that's why they're coming to the city.
I'm a great problem, and I've used interns and other cities in the very way that you're mentioning. We had a substantial program mingled with the use of interns. This was a problem, as we found that in most cases it took more time for staff to tell the intern what the story was than for staff to prepare a complete report to council use itself. What we ended up doing there, and what's going to work, is the intern was given sufficient time to really get into it, do a lot of the research himself. After a little bit, he did gain some ability to do that. However, this made the council have to wait for this information instead of as rapidly as it could.
Well, let me give you an example. When water has been one of the things that's been interested me. I know there are lots of publications that come through the reference library, for example. Things that never touch this office. Now, the basics that the staff have and the basics from the County Water Authority are readily available to us. This is no great problem. But how about all the other the attending things we can't keep track of? These individuals could do this kind of research.
What are we really trying to accomplish here? Now, you're going to have an organizational structure, and it's just the way we're set up. You have the manager form of government, right?
Yep.
Right, kind of. Okay. Well, so now what are all of us going to try to do? Are all of us going to try to be in a part-time job as knowledgeable as the manager is on everything, plus everything else is political besides that, and have all these reports running through us?
That
isn't going to go. But
Harry, I was serious when I suggested that we have some sort of retrieval where we talk about information that's on all areas, the problem affecting cities. And it's not to say, we're not talking about a great big data processing or anything of this nature, but if you're interested in a specific subject matter, you can go somewhere and pull forth all the information that's been accumulated daily on this subject.
This is available to some extent at the present time through the Governmental Reference Library, which is maintained jointly by the city and the county, which any one of our staff or any member of the council can make a request there for information on any subject, and they'll dig it up for you.
This is Lee.
It's in the county.
She'll deliver it to your office, so don't worry about that. They'll deliver it.
Governmental Reference Library.
In the county building.
They accumulate all the literature and that on each subject as it affects city and county governments, and it gets away from just city outlook on it too, because it takes in the broader stuff. I think it's an excellent source.
Do we have a catalog or directory on that information that's there, or do they have it available?
Yeah.
Where do we find that?
To give you a personal experience, so I'm taking one area like High Rise. Went down there and asked for everything from federal legislation to the IRS, the Internal Revenue Rule, and so on, and they come back with a complete package. They assemble it for you and everything. And
it's really
good.
Here you
what I'm asking
is
about, again, the governmental library. I would think that a directory would be in this building, so that you can scan this stuff when you're short of ideas.
It's only a matter of telephone.
The problem with that.
You don't give them time.
This is a continually additive process in the GovReference library.
Every day something.
You try to keep them up to date.
She
does
the digest of all of the periodicals as well as books and pamphlets and all that.
I think Helen, in a different light though, Helen, because I have had some experience before as the trainees come in from the school, but what we're trying to do is, Floyd saying, is condense a lot of the information that comes to us so that we can accept more information. And one of the big things is, like, when I'll read the planning report or read the park and rec board, there are certain things somebody else, like I'm sure the mayor does, has the staff goes through and underlines in red the highlights of the things. And you can just pick it up, just as like we come in with the clipping deal in the office. You can get an idea. Instead of going through the whole paper, you can find out things that are pertinent to the city to give you an idea of the flavor of what the press is saying about the city. This I think would be a lot more effective than establishing the committees. And if we are going to assign individuals to an area, like you take water, then will let one person be responsible in being the expert for the council for water? I don't know. So many of us have so many different ideas, like take industrial development. Al has some very definite ideas, some of which, like even the meeting we went to, others of us disagreed with, yet he probably knows more about this than a lot of us. If we all have our own individual ideas on the area of industrial development.
Well, speaking of that, Your Honor, on the industrial development, Mr. Walsh is quite right. I have some definite ideas and made them known to the public hearings in the council chambers, but I'm not always able to get other individuals on the council or the community to accept my ideas on it. But I do think it's better to present an idea and even have it rejected rather than to at least have it considered, rather than for us not to be thinking of something at all. And so that's the reason why many times I've put things out on the table hoping that I'd get consideration, and maybe somebody else would develop a better idea.
Well, you're probably the best example. Now, you bounce in more than any of us on different commissions and everything from the Board of Zoning Appeals to Industrial Development and sit in on it. I think you do have a real good grasp of the whole thing. But if we start assigning different areas and so on to the individual, I just think that the weight of it will make us less effective than more effective as a council, and this is why I would be afraid of it.
You know, one thing that might help, because we all have different areas of interest anyway, is just to let each other know of these things which we particularly interest in follow, so that if you want information, we probably know right away where to get it. or what was the last of us. This might be a good thing. Because I think we all pretty much have very specific interests anyway.
One of the fears that I have, Helen has a definite interest in legislation. She has meetings on legislation, which of course we all had the opportunity to go to, but quite often we don't find the time to go to. And we get, I think we get reports and recommendations of Helen's thinking, and I don't know how much of the staff and how much of an impartial, it's more of a legislative impression, and it's only a natural thing to happen. And I'm wondering if that is not worse than if we got, say, the manager's prejudice reports and opinions as opposed to a councilman.
You're going to get that anyway. Now you'd have the benefit of both sides of the subject rather than one side.
Yeah. But who should be more informed on the whole field of legislation? One person who has the full-time duties of everything else from the clouded alleys to the backed up sewers to major problems of the transit rezoning and so on. Then if we took our major areas and had administrative experts in that field to try and compile and report to the council on a periodic basis or a condensed basis.
Once again, I would suggest you file the whole thing. We'll get at it and treat it individually when the subject comes up.
Well, this is wrong, Frank, because we've got a problem and ducking it or sticking our head in the sand is going to solve it. And just because we don't go for this particular one don't mean we should do nothing.
Well, it does. Let's take them one at a time when they come up on a specific subject. We've got one before us right now, and that's a continuing liaison with our legislative representative through the legislative committee. And again, I'm real concerned about this for the very simple reason that you said. One woman's opinion on in terms of digest or legislation may not be good, and that's why I suggested we back her up with some additional.
Did you underline woman?
Yeah, but here we've got
underlaid.
Craig, on this, the staff and the legislative committee will finalize the suggestions they'd like to make to council probably Friday.
Here's the problem on that. We've got the manager who has a complete backlog and information on all of the state programs and the legislation affecting the city. Then we've got our legislative advocate whose responsibility is to the council and to the manager to keep us abreast and so on this. Following up on keeping us abreast, then we have a council representative who is chairmaning the committee and so on, who is just came back. And I think what we're doing is, I think we're just paramounting all of the levels of people responsible back to the council. So is Bud then responsible to Helen? Is the manager then in legislation and in those areas report to the legislative committee, which comes back to us that way, or can it come directly to the council as a whole? And I think we put too many layers of padding in between. We may make ourselves less effective.
I think you have a misconception of the legislative committee.
You do.
We'll bring that up.
Let me ask you a question.
The manager has, the staff has these problems. And what do you fellows do? Get together about once a month for a couple of days and sit down, lock everything out, and sit down and get at these things? We have the League of California Cities. We go up there once a year and we try and get it all done. Maybe we should be getting together of that type. I mean, who says we just have to get together twice a week and get lost? We could very well do the same thing. I mean, it's working. Let's take some of the examples of working organizations and see what they're doing, not try and dream up a new one.
Look, Jerry, we can get information to League of California Cities more than once a year because we have a local...
I'm not talking about that, Helen. I'm talking about sitting down across the table and just like we are this morning and coming up with these answers and the problems and solve them.
Like we're sitting up here friendly discussing.
No, but this kind of thing is what it's done.
I don't want any more reports out of it.
Twice a month here in San Diego County.
Just
move, we file a whole matter. Time.
Each of us set up our own empires and forget it.
Forget it.
I think what we need is a reader's planner. Particularly on city attorney's report.
Okay. Motion to file. Take it off the docket, anyway.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Sure. Get on to the docket. 9 o'clock.
On the
page one, we have item five. We have a report on your bed. Might suggest you read the mayor or the manager's report on item number five. You're going to get into it.
$1.2 million is an estimated amount. We do not know the exact amount of reimbursement which will be received in connection with the flood control channel or the off-site work on Friars Road, and therefore at this time it will have to stand as an estimated amount. We believe we've allowed some leeway there, and we will come out favorable to the budget amount for site grading, which was $1.3 million.
Where do we get the additional fill for the 5 feet, which I think is a good idea?
Reading of the flood control channel to its full width. Originally, it was proposed to have a channel, a type of a pilot channel, which would have provided about 10,000 cubic second feet capacity. We're now enlarging it, and even without the concrete lined channel, it will have a capacity of about 40,000 second feet. It will be substantially larger. We ran some material checks on this, and it's excellent material. We will use it in the site for site grading, and thereby raise the level of site.
Now's the time to sell larger flood channels, then.
Yes, sir.
In addition to that, this also encompasses a possibility of reimbursement from the federal project
once
it's underway.
Now, that reimbursement will not be available to the city until the flood control project is funded by the United States Congress and the project actually left. So there might be a time lapse of years involved here before we get our money back from that aspect. The authorization bill did provide for refunding to the city for work done on the channel.
Any questions on that?
What's the actual height of the area over mean high tide, over the mean water level?
Roughly. Yeah, 55 feet. I believe we're about 7 or 8 feet over the high.
The highest high
level that was just the 100-year flood level.
How far?
7 feet.
7 feet.
Yeah. We were about 2 feet originally.
Like one of the extra.
That flood level they had too is due to a big stoppage of the bridge.
Well, the 100-year flood level is the maximum, based on the Corps' estimate of everything, the poorest situation as far as flooding is concerned that could ever happen in history. And that's what they take the 100-year storm on. Now, actually, a 50-year storm, which is one we can readily expect, is only a few feet below that, however. Some people say, well, you're basing all your estimates on this 100-year storm, but that's essentially there isn't that much difference between a 50-year storm, which can readily happen, and this theoretical major ultra storm.
Relatively, what do we run into with this recent storm in relation to a 50-year or 100-year?
Oh, we're nowhere near.
Nothing.
We had, I think, 1,000 or 1,500 second feet, and a 50-year storm, 40,000 second feet.
Almost 3 times as bad.
30 times.
And we had that in 1916? Yeah.
We had 1916 was 56 or 7,000 second feet.
Yeah.
1927, I believe, was 48,000, and 1937 was 45,000 or something in that general order.
This is an unfortunate thing about that article appeared in the paper comparing local rain with the 1916 flood.
Yes.
that sure did a lot of damage to the conflict of the people and their ability to handle sharp flooding. I've seen a heck of a lot worse rains than this, and they weren't on the 50-year cycle, and that's been in the last 20 years.
Something on the 10 to 15,000 level, it's about one-third of what...
Well, no, this was 1,500 seconds.
1,500?
Yeah.
That's about a 30th.
Well,
about a 30th.
It was about a 30th of the major storm.
Well, I wasn't impressed with so much.
Remember, though, this is partially due to the fact that all our reservoirs in the back country have been empty. If they were all filled and we had the same storm, the situation might be substantially different than it was this time. Because the runoff in all the back country is all hell. None of it got down into Mission Valley.
But then how much water did we pick up?
Well, we've got a couple of months supply now out of it. And to gauge that with what capacity is still left in the reservoir system, we would have about 2 years supply, or a little bit more than that, 2.5 years supply if our reservoirs are completely filled. So
let me ask you a question.
So there's a lot of capacity left there, yeah.
Let me ask you a question. You talk about this flood capacity and so forth. Basically, this has nothing to do with the rainfall in itself. Number one, the ground has to be filled. If the ground is filled up with water, plus our reservoirs are full, then the same rain might have been 10 or 15 times.
That's correct.
Is that correct?
Yeah. Then the same rain might have been.
As far as the rainfall, we broke records in the rainfall in a given period of time, but we had the capacity to absorb it in our systems, where in 1916 you didn't.
That's correct.
You had a dam bust out, a few things like that. The railroad says we'll block it all in.
Well, there was one other factor in these two most recent storms, and that is that the high concentration was in the coastal area, not in the back country. So actually, we didn't create a big runoff situation from the total drainage area. Had we done that, it would have been more difficult.
Floods in the highlands could kill us.
Yeah.
Well, it rained here,
huh?
Well,
it
rained here, huh? Okay. Any questions on the side? Anything else on page one? Yes, Your Honor, I'd like to ask on item 7. Now, this is miscellaneous traffic signs, but does not have anything to do with our street signs. Is that right?
No, this is no parking, yield signs, stop signs, this type of thing.
Not the name of
traffic
the
control
sign.
Yield right away?
Yeah.
Yeah. Across the line of yellow?
Yeah. The reason I ask that, Mr. Manager, is because there's quite a bit of interest in our community when street name signs come up, that we have more readable signs and some that you can see at night. And I've mentioned it several times, and I want to keep on mentioning it, because so that I can have it on your mind when you're considering street name signs.
I'd like to compliment whoever came up with this big red sign that says wrong way, which is real good.
That's an excellent idea.
State highway
on the right side three times since then.
There's a real interesting story behind this guy one of the suburbs of Los Angeles called in and suggested that his name was John Wrong Way. He's running for assembly up there now.
He just lost. Page 2?
No, I just lost. Number 8. We have a list, Marty, of those that we can get a copy of with the major reason that...
Okay, we have a copy of that.
One other thing I asked for is... council meeting when we discussed the new council policy on trees in the middle strip that the community could participate on. I asked for a list of those in my district. And I was wondering if you make a note of that and get it, and I just thought of it now.
So what's the...
We had new council policy that we recommended when we reconstruct or widen streets that we will consider putting trees in at the same time. And then also we have a program where the community can participate in streets where there are center planning strips. Remember we discussed that policy? And I just wanted a list of the one undeveloped center plannings in my district. Because, there aren't. Which is district?
One.
Jack, there's none in my district.
These are in Mr. Scheidel's, Mr. and Tomorrow's, and Mr. Chase's district.
The older areas are getting even.
Right.
Oh,
finally catching up.
Let me point out on the last.
They couldn't do it before the election. Had to wait last year.
On the last contract for reconstruction, we covered the other districts.
Well, she isn't walking on the bar.
This is putting what we call a second story over the present pavement.
The Linda Vista Road is still unfinished for some of the right-of-way. Your curbs are set back and the street's finished and there's a no-man's land type deal under curbs and sidewalks.
Then we might have some reconstruction there. I'll check into it for you.
Okay. Anything else on page two? Anything else on page two? Page three?
On 104, what's the purpose of that?
104? Oh, this is to allow us to interchange by radio alert calls, pickup calls, vehicles. Wanted people, this type of thing, by radio, and it gives us an advantage of radio relays through the whole Southern California area, which makes this alert business practically an immediate one. The county will pay $90 of that, $180 a year. We feel it's well worth it to maintain this type of capability.
103,
may I ask one before that? Mr. Shadow, may I?
Sure.
On 101, in seeking this information, would this information be available from the present transit system, or is it necessary to get that?
They don't have this information, although they have quite a bit of the information necessary to put this report together, and they are cooperating with us on this.
They are?
So they could not supply the information that we needed.
They don't have an actuary, right?
So at this point, no one knows actually the value of the liability, whether it be a city acquisition or any of the others, so this is something that we have to have to know the value of this thing. We've heard figures from, all over the lot.
Are they participating in the cost of securing this information?
No. Actually, they're supplying the information, and the IBM cards are sort of thing that which they do have, and then this company has to put it together.
Just to find the ages and the numbers and the years of service, and
some of this, no doubt, would be recoverable, but
this isn't necessarily going to cost $2,000. It says
I would count on it costing $2,000, and
it says
it might
not
cost
to exceed.
Right.
Well, then it is not available to them, but they are going to supply the...
Right. Basic numbers.
Harry, is this a local outfit? I have not used my code shirt for them.
L.A.
L.A.
I was going to say, I couldn't answer that.
There's no danger of their not supplying, the transit system not supplying.
No, they've offered full cooperation on this.
Thank you.
They're very good at this. Anything else on page three?
On this 103.
Yeah. Now, we're keeping an update program going. We're going to anticipate 15,000 here from now on in and keep this updated. Is that it?
Yeah, and this is to provide service where we are involved in a design program or anything else where we do not have existing aerial photography that can be used for the design. Major facilities, we found it is cheaper for us to get our contours and ground the topography by aerial photograph work and by doing it by field crew.
We went through a program of Fairchild's, et cetera, and getting maps of all these layouts and so forth. Now, this is not a part of that. This is for specific major projects for concrete.
Well, it's to do both. Where we feel there has been sufficient change in any area where updating is required, we will use this.
This will actually update our
this will tend to update our total mapping program in the city on a continuous basis, because these projects, as we go along, what we'll do is take areas rather than strip the thing out.
Are there any areas within the city now which have not been aerial photographed and
that sort of great part of the city. No use of us getting aerial photographs in most of the undeveloped area of the city. This has been the most expensive thing and not of complete value to us. The only thing in those areas that we photographed is where we're doing some improvement work where the photographs are going to be of value.
Like San Vicente?
Yeah.
Where you're going to put your roads through and so forth?
That's right. And we did it for the stuff up north where we put in the Rancho Bernardo, the pipeline, all this type of stuff. We have photographs in there because we had a use for.
Well, I'm curious about this because naturally private individuals aren't going to do a great deal of this, and I'm wondering if we had this in somewhat detail, realizing there'd be a lot of money spent on it, if this wouldn't be of great value to those owners of the property, because it stands, they probably don't know what they've got, and something a service that they would cooperate with. I'm talking about a vast area that may not be developed, and here you're out trying to sell the community, and you really don't know what you're selling. I mean, and even the owners don't know. I'm wondering if there's the...
As I recall, I...
It's available on 200 scale on a major portion of undeveloped land. It's been accumulated either by the county or by the city when they were originally in the search out.
So then basically we can almost say that the total city has a 200 on it?
We have available, right?
A 200. And this would be a more concentrated or specific. Is that correct?
Right. We've done some specific work with developers too, as I recall, on a cooperative basis. All right.
But I thought we had the total city. In fact, it came to me last year, the year before, that we had one area that hadn't been, and we actually started redoing certain areas because they were developing even faster.
Well, some of this stuff dates way back, of course. Does not need to be brought up to do some work on it.
Okay.
Well, this won't necessarily cost $15,000. It's just for whatever work we do need.
That's correct. This is a requirement contract. Actually, we previously used to let this out to bid, and council will recall we recommended last year, because this thing was getting in the position of being a professional service, was recognized by professional engineering organizations as a professional service, that we would negotiate these contracts. We had 5 proposals submitted. These are the best. So they are in line, incidentally, with bids previously received for the same type of work, so we're not paying a greater sum for it. We actually feel we'll save money on this basis because we can call for it as we need it instead of having it done on a broad and sweep basis.
Waller, do we retain the rights, all the rights to the negatives and the reprints of the photos?
Yes.
The reason I ask this is because like the telephone company and the gas company have development sections, and they're continually surveying different areas, and I'm sure that some of the other development sections, if we didn't set up a service at the city, I don't know if there are any existing services within the community that we would be competitive with. But if we weren't, we could provide a service that, like we do on maps and other things like that.
Well, we make these available to them if they want to use them.
At a charge?
But we charge for duplicate prints of the thing.
Okay, and then we in some way then recover the cost for us. Possibly some of the cost of the
I think we've done it primarily as a service. We recovered our cost of training, supplying it to them, plus some little extra on it. But I doubt that it would repay us for the actual aerial survey work.
Okay. I had a further question.
Let's
see to the city attorney. I noticed 103 is tied into 114, whereupon we're going to establish the fund a little bit later. If we go ahead and deny 103, it'd be silly to do anything but deny 114. And if we pass 103, we'd have to pass 114.
That's right.
It'd be nice if we could combine them into the same little vote, but I see we're dealing with a resolution and with an ordinance, and it's probably going to require 2 separate votes.
That's right. You find this all the time.
Right. The last resolution was 112, and then the first ordinance was 113. If one was the setting aside of the $15,000, the other was the
authorization, then maybe we could pass it to them. It might save us a little bit of time if the two related items were to spoke to each other on the docket.
Yeah, but if you did that, you were coming up with a greater cost, because that resolution comes in and that ordinance comes in, and then Phil, the city clerk's office, gets additional resolutions, and if you start spending all of the time to coordinate resolutions back and forth, the cost of this city far exceeds the, I think, the benefit that we would get by having them put together.
That's why you have a note that says C-114.
Right,
we only have to have a note.
I'll just point out to you, 101, we don't have the accompanying ordinance. Through inadvertence, we didn't get the ordinance on the docket for a Thursday.
We really have no discussion on the ordinance once we decide to go along with the agreement.
Sure
we
do.
Sure.
Prove the method of financing, but didn't prove the funds.
You learn as you go along.
I was trying to cut down the number of a little bit of typing on our docket.
If I could double back, if someone probably from planning would know on item 11.
Item 11.
What's their final map coming in? Does anybody know? How this indicates they're fairly close to starting construction then, is that right? That's a big Holiday Inn project in the valley, does anybody know?
Nobody seems to be here to answer.
This would tend to indicate that. I don't have a specific answer to your question. We'll try to find it out for you.
Well, we saw one on
that. But this indicates that they're going ahead with it.
We've approved final maps before, and they've never materialized.
We didn't approve anything. We couldn't have a hole in the ground since
August? Let's see if we can get an answer for you, Jack. But I understand that this is coming to fruition because a gentleman from St. Louis, Missouri called me 3 or 4 days ago and said this man would be in San Diego and he wanted to come up to the office and meet me. So I presume something brewing.
Your Honor, before we...
St. Louis money.
Your Honor, before we leave page 3, I'd like to ask the manager about 102.
Item 102?
Not the soil investigation, but what is it?
Restrooms.
Development, restroom, children's school, and lifeguard tower.
Oh, this is part of our capital improvement program.
That's a new tower. Yes. Do you remember we gave an award for a designer, the lifeguard tower that was to an employee? Well, this is his design of tower.
It includes the children's pool?
Children's pool restroom.
Oh,
and the
children's
pool is there.
Oh, that's for the children's pool. Instead of the pool. It had me,
I wonder if you
that's what I'm looking for, Alan.
What'd you say,
Alan? That's what they use. I'm trying to teach these kids now.
The pool.
Yeah. They've been using it, now they want to put it in the camp.
I might explain one item on one matter in connection with 105, Mr. Mayor and members of council. In the past, there was no way that the city government could collect facts from other governmental agencies for assessments against governmentally owned property. It's now our understanding that there is a possibility with recent legislation for us to get some compensation back from the state. We are applying for it. We hope to get it. And we will reduce some of these expenditures rather materially if we do, because our main problem is with the state of California. But we still will not be able to collect from the federal government.
Okay. Page 4. 108. Let me get the policy out here just a minute. Where it is. 800-3 to be here on the bank.
Here's a copy of it if you'd like to.
I've got one all marked up here somewhere. I have some questions on it. On the first paragraph, local streets and alleys, it indicates to me here that if a person is not willing to give the property to the city at no cost, then we go ahead and acquire it and assess the district for it. Now the question that runs through my mind, and it's not clear here to me, is let's suppose that we take 20 pieces of property down one side of the street and 20 down the other, and all but one give the property to us.
Secretary.
The question that I have in mind, and it's not clear here, and I'd like to say clear if it's true, is that let's suppose each piece of property is worth $2,000. I don't want to see that $2,000 spread to everyone. I want to see $2,000 each person and give them credit for what they dedicate so that that man who is trying to hold up the rest of the district gets nailed to the whole thing.
That's correct. That's what happens.
Does
is that what it says?
Says giving appropriate credit to the right-of-way dedicated.
Well, of course, appropriate credit is not...
We do it rather than by the assessment deal,
okay,
by giving credit against the total assessment of each parcel. It works out just the way you mentioned it.
Good. Okay, well, I just want that real clear, because this being the case, I feel that the man who is not giving his property must certainly realize that he's still going to pay for it, so why don't he give it? And if this is real clear...
This is the way it's supposed to be done. We could not do this previously, so you know. The state law did not put provision for our giving credit for gift to right-of-way. And unfortunately, if we got everything gifted under the circumstances you mentioned, where we got everything gifted except one parcel, which we had to go in and condemn and purchase, then the cost was spread over the entire district. No credit was given for the gifting. Now we can do it in the reverse order through change in the
There's nothing I don't want to happen, and that is where you have a sliver of maybe 1 foot all the way down the street, and then the street swings in and takes 10 and 20 feet. I don't think that that man should be required to give 20 feet for free when the others only give one. I do feel that that should be spread. Now, this is the thing I'm trying
to say. That's why I think we've used the terminology here, giving appropriate credit for right-of-way dedication without cost, because you do run into variables in this thing, and you can't make it positive in the sense
right.
you were first mentioning because of that.
Right, for the base.
You do take a quarter of one chap's lot, maybe only 2 feet off the other person's, obviously you ought to give greater credit to the fellow who gives the big chunk of land.
Okay, so actually what you're doing is establishing, when you spread your assessment, you're establishing a value of each piece of property
that's
taken. It might be $2 here and it might be $2,000 down the street.
That's
and that man gets full credit again. I just want to know, so when I'm explaining
what
it to someone, I'll get my head chopped.
One quick question. In a case where a person does not give their property and then you credit all of the others with an equal value for their property in front, does the 10% incidental cost then apply to the fictitious increments as well as the actual cost of the project?
No.
See, right now we have 10% charge for incidentals, legal, processing, and so on. And I would think that the 10% would not apply to the... Like if one guy doesn't sell and his value is 2,000 and there's 50 people along there and we multiplied the same 2,000 by 50 and took 10% of the 100,000 figure, which would increase the incidental cost by $10,000. Is that, are we protected against that? Because I don't think that's what's intended by this, is it?
Walter, I think they have an answer to the court. In this case, the
average cost
pick up, John.
Pick up, John.
Pick up, John. Bail me out.
That's right.
They use an average cost derived from the cost of the acquisition of the particular property that they have acquired. And this average cost includes the cost of incidental.
I can see where that might be, Jack, because really when you take and separate a piece of property, you have engineering work, you have appraisal costs, you have legal costs, and even docket costs where you're running these deeds through, et cetera, even if you're just buying and selling back.
Well, and the way it's figured now, Harry, is that say we have a project that everybody gives the land and it's a, say, a $10,000 project, and all the land is given. Now, if the land had to go in at... it's fair value, even though only one held out, say at $1,000 a lot, and there's 10 lots, so it would be an additional $10,000 for right-of-way, even though the cost is only of one lot, the $1,000. You would have a total project cost of $20,000. And you take 10% of that, you come up with $2,000, whereas you take 10% of $11,000, you come up with a different figure.
Maybe I can ask a question that would answer that.
Am I?
If we take the 10%, do we always charge the 10%, or do we charge that which we need out of the 10%? What happens?
I think what we ought to do, to clarify Costco's mind on this, if you wish, is you give us these specific conditions, we'll work out specific answers. Again, a number of variables. I thought John answered both of those questions, but...
Well, it's a general question in a general area, I mean, in a large portion of it. Basically, right now, how do you charge your 10% on a project for incidental?
Well,
approval on a total project cost. Okay. Now, under the new policy, the total project cost, if we condemn one land, that adds to the cost of the project, right? But we're also throwing in an equal value for all of the others so that we can get this condemned property back to the frontage, to the people who are condemned. Do we take a 10% of the total cost plus the condemned property, or do we take a 10% of the total project, the condemned property, and the value of the other?
You're missing the boat. We're not adding that cost to it. We're only using that in the proration of the system, right?
Right.
You're not adding it to the cost.
Well, no, then the question we got out of John is wrong. Basically, what you've got a relatively small project, but there's massive land transfers back and forth. Maybe it's 10 times the price of the project. I'm exaggerating this. Now, so actually, we're just trading paperwork, and it might be $50,000, shall we say, which 10% of that is $5,000. Now, the question I think that Jack is hitting is, if these people all agree to give it, do you put it in at zero, or do you put it in at $50,000, or if all but one gives his land for free, then do we come up to $50,000? How are you establishing the value of the property? Is there somebody from the apartment going out and appraising the value of all of this land, whether it's given or not? And that is put into the total transaction, and 10% added for that for contingency.
That's for the wording of the state code. You use an average cost per square foot. In other words, if you acquire 1,000 square feet and it costs you $10,000, plus, say, $1,000 for incidental, the cost per square foot of that particular property is $1.10 per square foot. And this average square foot cost is used for credit establishment of all the property that's given.
But if no one charges for it,
then you get a zero.
Then you get a zero. Now, this is the question that Jack asked. If
there is no 10% on that portion.
Well, wait a minute. You extend this thing out, and you've got 100 lots, and it's all zero. But all of a sudden, some guy says, no, I'm not going to do it. You're going to have to take it from me. So now, this particular lot, 1%, establishes at $2 a square foot. Now we go back and put $2 a square foot on all of them. Is that correct? Okay, so now here's what we're talking about. We're talking about two identical projects sitting side by side. One, everybody gets it for free, so the $50,000 worth of property is now zero, because that's the way you put it through, as you just said. So they save themselves that 10% or $5,000. This other one, one little lot, says, no, we want it. So all of a sudden, these people have to pay an additional $5,000 if you establish a fair value on all of the lots. Is that what you have?
10% is only applied to the expenditure.
Well, and this isn't a fair thing.
Yes, sure
it
is. Yes, it is.
This is for the guy that won't go along with the dedication, and then the 10% is applied on that.
Let me ask this. The only portion of that which goes into the total cost is that which you actually have to pay for. Is this correct?
Right.
All right, and then the rest of it is simply a matter of credit on the assessment. Yeah, the total job remains the same.
Okay, basically the answer to my question would be, do you charge 10% on the credits given?
No.
All right.
It's not a total part of the
system. That procedure is not set up in this right-of-way acquisition section. We don't do it.
Well, it's not real, still not real clear and real defined, because, again, if you only spread that one lot, is that guy going to get the charge? You got $50,000 of acquisition and give back, or credits. But this one fellow, he's going to get tied for 10%, and the others are not. I think it should be spelled out pretty clear in here. I mean, it's a basic policy decision, and I think that we should know what it is. It don't say here.
Well, isn't the 10% only a part of that which we purchased, so it would be a part of the cost of acquiring that, and that is what he has to pay for.
Look, if it's not clear to us here, and we have a policy for everyone to work by the same set of rules, I think it at least ought to be darn clear to us here. If everybody in the city is going to work by a set of rules, and I don't think it's in here.
I might suggest to the manager that when we had the spread of assessments on the various types of streets, we had Ed Gabelson work up some charts, remember, showing the 20-foot strip and the center strip and all these, and we set them up on the board.
Yeah, but we never had this involved in it.
Well, what I was going to suggest to the manager is that we take some typical examples here and make a couple of charts and set them up here so we can...
How are we coming along with the 1911 Act film that we were going to have, that we would show before here? We're going to have one on planning too, remember?
One answer to Harry's
I think our policies have to be general, and what I think what Harry was asking to be included in the policy is the 1911 Act procedure itself, which, mainly because of our being unfamiliar with the details of it, and I don't think it would be wise, Harry, for us to spell the policy out in so much detail if it's already included in the 1911 Act procedure.
All I'm talking about, Jack, is a relatively simple thing. We're going to be sitting on assessment hearings in here. And it's almost inconceivable to me that anyone would hold out if they know they're going to suffer this penalty. Now, the question is, are they penalizing their neighbors who have given their property in any way or not? And by reading this, it wasn't clear to me, or I wouldn't have been asking these questions. Now, if it's not clear to me, I'm trying to figure out what's going to happen to the average citizen or the average staff member down the line. If we have different standards, we're going to be in trouble.
Well, it does seem to me, if that is the worry, and I don't have the rest of the proceedings or the policy under 800-3, but that ought to be not in the right-of-way acquisition section, but in the section that covers these contingent fees that are charged against the district.
Well, I think a hypothetical assessment district with both conditions on the board, like you say, would help. And then as long as
I thought we had given a few of these at conference, but then I'm not sure whether all of you were at the conference.
Your Honor,
we had a conference on that.
Your Honor, we spent about an hour on this in the council conference, and all of us helped develop this.
Well, fine, but I don't recall it, Mrs. when I was gone.
No,
it had been about a week ago, and
this was gone through very thoroughly, and many of the things you suggested were incorporated into this policy.
Well,
it isn't like if it was presented this morning for the first time and we hadn't had an opportunity.
Mr. Blanchett, we had this policy before us in the conference.
Yes, Harry, you were in Fort Lauderdale.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Shadow.
Yeah, you were.
I thought I was losing my mind.
But,
impossible.
But the council, during your absence, developed this policy and
what's this? Okay, one other question then on C. Well, the city engineer may initiate acquisition of property. Now, this is before the council has any knowledge of this. What do we mean by and B?
B.
Oh, we provided that, number one, we do give you the capital improvement program. It sets out a six-year program for construction of streets on the select street system. We will also submit, and we have submitted with this, a listing of all those projects where property is supposed to be acquired during the current fiscal year and the estimated cost of acquisition.
You say I got a list of this?
Yep, there should be.
I'm wondering if, as a suggestion,
maybe we should lay this over.
At that conference, I think it was just Ivor, myself, Hahn, and Hitch, where we just had a minimum to have it. So it might not be a good idea to continue this item so that we could schedule another conference on it so that all of the council could get in on the discussion, and unless there's some pending project that would be affected.
Mr. Hitch?
Your Honor, then if what you're suggesting, Mr. Walsh, takes place, then those of us that were here, the four of us that were here and helped develop this, then our time was absolutely a complete waste. What you're suggesting is that nothing can happen unless the entire council is here. Somewhere along the line, our colleagues have to have faith in those that were here and develop the policy.
Isn't it quite obvious, Alan, that they don't?
Well,
it was obvious earlier this morning.
This is a good example of the committee.
Well, we were not in Fort Lauderdale either, and we don't know what happened down in Fort Lauderdale. But we were here.
What happened in Fort Lauderdale? And what's it been to prove it? Seven of the salesmen, you remember that line?
They got five guys to vote it down. Okay.
Hey, what happened? We lost that Model 3 thing.
There are projects that are...
I didn't even get the full reports on it, so, I mean, I'm in trouble.
They're probably on your desk, but the...
I got this.
But there are some accelerated projects that are quite important to the people that want them to go forward. And
I'm sure there are. In fact, there's some I want to. I just want to know what this says. And
there's one in my district that I'm very, very interested in.
College?
You know, it's University Avenue.
The manager's report, there was attached a list of proposed right-of-way acquisitions.
University Avenue, probably known as the Euclid, is very important to some of my constituents.
You're going to get assessed?
Ha!
didn't even know I was there. Okay, now one other question that probably solved it for me, and that is on C, on approved project, if it is necessary to acquire property on project not included in the approved annual program, or if the city costs on approved project are increased by 25% or more, the council will be notified. What does 25% amount to dollar-wise? What are we talking about? Like, we're authorizing 24% go-ahead without notifying the council, so what are we talking about money in 24%?
This is going to vary depending upon the project that's involved.
A million-dollar project, that would be $250,000.
$100,000
project? Then we're authorizing then on a million-dollar project, the $240,000 can go ahead without the council knowing it. Is that correct? Is that what this says?
Well, remember, yes. This does say that. Your capital improvement program, as we explained, is based on land valuations estimated without appraisal. Now,
I would like to see a freeze dollar limit on that. I don't want to open the door to $240,000 on a million-dollar project. At first glance, it don't look good to me that way. That's another question.
May I suggest this to council, because I think you have to look. The million-dollar project's the unusual. Most of our projects are down in the $40,000 to $50,000 class on right-of-way acquisition.
So we're talking about $62,000 then, huh? Something like that.
$25,000, $50,000, $12,500. Now, we're fortunate when we get right-of-way costs, if we can get that close, the appraised values might very well come in. Both under and over. We don't expect this all to be over. We expect some of them to be the other direction. There ought to be a degree of balance to this by the time we end up with right-of-way acquisition, and this has proven out in the past pretty well from our estimates. But generally speaking, the total expenditure is less than the amount we set out for.
We talk about some of them that get pretty big, like out around University City on some of these things, you know.
That is why we put this proposal in here, and this, I think, was what council suggested us.
A question. I feel we're holding that second conference right now on the policy. Rather than hold another conference, Al, how about a week's continuance if this wouldn't hold up anything so that the councilmen who have questions can get in touch with the manager and the engineer's office to get an explanation of it and might answer a lot of these questions?
Well, I won't even worry about that. I mean, I've called my fears and questions to the attention of the council if they've considered them, and I feel that this is okay and there's no problem there. Fine, let's let it roll.
Harry, there were four of us that considered them. Now,
Did you consider my questions?
I know that four of mine aren't as good as nine, but we did the best we could do with what was available.
You're working with a strip inventory, huh?
Anything else on page four? You're setting us up now. Be careful. There's some great
lines.
Wait
till they find everything else the former council handled in your absence. I found all sorts of things happen when I was in it.
Page four?
Your Honor, on 110, there's a B section there involving the denial of a claim to Russell G. French. I don't know if individuals are notified that this is going to come up on the docket, but this gentleman called me and he asked, he said he had not been notified that this was going to be on the docket. He wants to appear, and he asked the council to consider the B section here a continuance of 1 week that would allow him to appear before the council and give his side of this claim.
I think we're turning our council into a courtroom, man. I think the proper recourse is to file a claim in that court at 59.
Matter of fact, he did not file within the period of 100 days, and you have no jurisdiction anyway, because it's a matter of jurisdiction that if you don't file within the 100-day period, you're out of court. He did not file within that period, so that you can't even, there's no basis to consider it.
Correct.
Even if we wanted to.
Even if you wanted to. Has he been notified of this?
Yeah.
Mr. Mayor, on 109, I'd like to ask the city attorney, these are a couple little items involving a city car hitting another car. Do we get a release of all claims that may arise out of this at the time, so if somebody comes back with a crook in their neck 7 months later, they can't say, well, you admitted that you did a $200 worth, now you owe me $20,000.
We don't tender the check until we have a written waiver. That's probably on the back of the check.
Of
release.
That'll be where you sign the back of the check, Mike.
Can't endorse it. Sign the statement.
We had one guy up there, and we wouldn't do anything. And I handed him the check with one hand and the release with the other. We both held on until and then let go sign the statement.
That must have been quite a show.
It was.
Why don't you take and put it right on the back of the check?
Mr. Morrow, a councilman, also everything in connection with that, like for instance, there was the operations building that was in that. You remember, each individual item on that will be on the docket and come before the council for consideration. Page 5.
I have a comment on 115 and 116. These seem to me to be items that might be best put on a monthly little report to the council rather than put on the docket for our consideration at council and in chambers. That's my view of it.
I think the charter required is a report. This is one report that I read all the time. Another piece of paper wouldn't impress me.
It's my understanding that this was a charter requirement.
I wasn't aware of that.
We don't know. Check it out, Mike.
Motion to adjourn?
On item, I wanted to ask a question on this item 113.
113, yes.
Have we got what our intent and purpose is on that thing spelled out? On why we're changing the code?
This is not
there's a policy. This is not a policy. This is changing the ordinance.
But there's a policy that states that you have those.
That already should be in. This is only changing one section of the entire policy. It's just changes section 13.
When you're introduced to this matter, can we in any way amend them?
You can always amend the code.
John, I'm talking about amending this particular ordinance.
At introduction is when we do amend it. If it's at adoption the following week, we have to reintroduce it the following week. But we can amend. Like you're talking about the change, Your Honor.
Yeah.
If we wanted to change some of the wording in that at introduction, we could do it in the chambers and have the attorney just write it in.
Sure, and that could be the introduction of the ordinance so amended.
This gets very, very dangerous. I think the perfect example of that is the contract for the Anza trailer park that was written in the council chambers. Very lethal.
Yeah.
We've been paying for it ever since.
I was just going on the suggestion that Mayor Curran had when this was discussed here of putting a 6-month limitation on it.
6 months?
What we're doing is changing the conditional use permit to include a larger category.
What this really does, and Mayor, I'd like to correct the misapprehension in the minds of the press in an editorial and an article that appears in one of our leading newspapers, calling this the Butler Amendment. What this really does is bring our code into line with our administrative practice, which commenced in 1936, and has ever since continued with respect to this, the development of natural resources. And this causes the code to conform to what the administrative practice of the city has been over these years.
What he's saying is the administrative policy changed the law in 1936, and we're making honest people out of them.
Yeah.
There was one language missing.
Yes.
One of the questions I would have, which comes to mind, maybe I should ask it in there. If you amend the conditional use permit to permit a certain use, then conditional use permits are of the type that each use is specified and the requirements are put in the conditional use. Then those conditional use permits that are already in existence under the previous clause of 13, would they have to refile under the new section 13?
Grandfather clause would apply.
We would think so, because I believe the law of the case would be that in this particular area, by reason of the expenditure of money and the activities conducted for a number of years,
we've established
an administrative precedent
which is the nature of an estoppel, and I doubt very much that we'd be in any position to move against anybody that was already acting on
it. This wouldn't expand the present use of conditional use permits.
Not with respect to the natural resources, because the way we've been administering conditional use permits in this area has been just like this schedule here speaks. And I wouldn't think it would expand beyond what the practice already is.
Basically, the difference between this and what previously was in the code is the expansion of language, which clarifies what the original intent, not what the original intent was, but the original execution was.
Yeah.
What I don't know what the intent was, but the execution.
Question, though, on the in the conditional use permits that are spelled out, see, where they're only in rock and gravel activities, could they, with the passage of this, then automatically expand to the manufacture of products?
You mean without changing their original
without changing their conditions?
No.
No, we they can't modify their original.
But if they were in the manufacture of these products already, then under the grandfather clause and so on, they would not have to reapply. Okay.
Yeah. Probably, yeah. I think the grandfather is a good enough.
They can't change the conditions of the conditional use permit without a modification of the permit.
We would continue, I would think, sit on top of these applications as they come in, and to the end, if they don't go beyond what the intention of this thing is.
One question on the unanimous consent, unless someone else has some more questions on what
this is. You got any unanimous consent there?
Yeah, I have a unanimous consent here. It's just declaring the existence of a local disaster area. And one of the requirements are that the governor concur in our declaration. And I'm wondering if there's any way that someone could check the governor for at least his feeling or inclination, but I just, if he's going to not declare it, I would not, for just public relations reasons, declare ourselves a disaster area and have him turn his name.
This is a mechanical routine thing that he will acquiesce to on the basis of his signature is required for the federal funding.
Okay.
It's a routine procedure. Well, always has been.
Yeah, they have declared under circumstances, certainly not much different than our situation here. That's probably less of a problem in our situation. Now, that's all we can go on. We can certainly no way guarantee that he's going to declare. They send a man down to look over our situation.
The mudslides up in La Canada and so on in the past have always been handled this way as far as the L.A. city and county is concerned.
Right.
Doing the same kind of thing. It just opens the door. I hate this expression, but it opens the door for federal funding for reimbursement of some abnormal expenses. We're not a disaster area in the sense that everybody's evacuated, but it's the only expression we can use in order to qualify.
This is one of the reasons I might point out that no action was taken to make any declaration during the storm, because we didn't consider the storm in essence any real critical problem. We were meeting the problem with our own forces and did not need outside forces. This is an enabling type of thing. If we're going to get any federal assistance for $500,000 expenditures of $400,000, that we might get into, this is the way we'll have to do it.
I had a question on the unanimous consent item concerning the $2 million land purchase item for the stadium. I noticed that the escrow and title expense is $8,200, all being borne by the purchaser on that. Well, normally your escrow fee is split between the buyer and the seller pays your title policy, but I see by the court order, which was attached to it, that they're to take the sales price free of any of these expenses, so I guess that's why we are bearing all of them in this case.
Correct.
There's $16,000 for contingencies and $32,000 for moving costs. I have no idea what the $48,000 is for. Does somebody know what moving cost, what we're moving on?
Moving cost is the cost of our getting the present lessees and sublessees off the property so we can get in.
And the contingencies are normal and unknown things.
Yeah.
Those are the normal contingencies.
Jeremy,
Mayor, the general subject was before the Park and Recreation Board for a period of about 6 months, I believe, Doug. And it was initiated originally by the so-called Northern Area Committee of the Park Board. And I know there has been interest in the council on the subject before that, too.
and it was considered in all the area subcommittees of the Park and Rec Board and on a couple of occasions by the board itself, and wound up with this suggested set of criteria for the dedication of park. There's been a number of different ways that parks have been acquired by the city, so that we don't have any existing uniform pattern in relation to how parks have been acquired. Some of them have sufficient restrictions around them that perhaps they don't require dedication, but in most cases, that becomes a question of what is the appropriate time to set aside and dedicate a park property. Because once it is dedicated, why then it requires a vote of the people to undedicate it. So these suggested criteria have been set up that when they're met, that a park be dedicated. A, that the site is in accordance with a area or community development plan approved by the Planning Commission and Council. B, that a site development plan has been prepared, that is for the park site itself. C, that the site is either developed, partially developed, or scheduled for development within the 6-year capital improvement program. And D, that there are no foreseeable circumstances whereby the city may improve the choice of site or boundaries by exchange or sale.
Ask you on C. It says here that the site is to be developed or scheduled for development in the 6-year capital improvement program. How about the dedication of park sites, for instance, in anticipated subdivision? Let's Penasquitas, for instance, or something like this that may not develop for the next 6 to 10 years.
Item number 2.
Oh, pardon. Okay.
I think this looks forward to the fact that hopefully we'll be doing
more
considerably more dedication by subdivision.
I'll go ahead and finish, because you've left out the one, I think, the North Carolina, the Claremont one is dedicated by the criteria.
As we mentioned to the people in La Jolla, the rest of the whole city.
Which particular site was that, John?
And the canyon, take a look.
Let's work on the policy.
Finish up the city.
Okay, and the third, or another special category, is when the site is acquired by gift or grant, that if the deed contains a restriction limiting the use of the land for park or recreation purposes, the dedication by ordinance would not be necessary. But on the other hand, if there were no such deed restriction, the site would be considered for dedication by ordinance if it meets the other criteria. Well, I didn't bother to read it because something says that where it is dedicated by subdivision map, that it may in most cases not be necessary to have a separate dedication ordinance in that instance.
Putting it on a map doesn't guarantee its perpetuity.
If the conditions of the dedication in the subdivision agreement are such that the land may not be disposed of without a vote. And I think that this has been left a little bit open because we still don't have an ordinance with reference to the required dedication of land and subdivision. And I would assume that at some time, if we do have such an ordinance, that we would make suitable provisions of the terms that have to go into the subdivision dedication. Any comment on that?
The point I was getting at is that this merely indicating on a subdivision map, even with a designation, doesn't in any way guarantee in perpetuity. Mr. Attorney?
Well, the as you know, Mayor, the present addition to the Subdivision Map Act states that the city by ordinance may require dedication of park sites if other criteria are met, some of which we are not able to meet.
You've answered it all in a different way. You said if the city by an ordinance requires dedication, well then this is unnecessary. Because that's exactly what we're talking about.
No. dedication of the subdivision. Now, some of these, the attorney says, are restricted, the city cannot dispose of them, others not. Fitzpatrick went over several of these, and some of them we can, if we want to, should be dedicated if we want to protect them. Others, well, there's nothing the city can do to dispose of. So these parks which we've acquired, some of them in the southern part of the city, or the central part of the city.
Talking about Golden Hills?
No, I'm talking about Azalea Park,
Grant
was, City Heights, and a number of those things, where they have to kind of be considered individually.
If there's any doubt at all why there should be a dedication ordinance.
And yet this is almost exactly the opposite. What was decided, or what was talked about 4 or 5 years ago in relation to park lands, that we were going to dedicate less and less of it so that we'd have the flexibility to use.
Not the opposite. One of the purposes there is a big pressure on now to have land dedicated. We're trying to draw a policy up to establish when lands will be dedicated, and they will only be dedicated if it's absolutely certain that area will be developed as a park. That's the objective we're trying to achieve.
Aren't the conditions under which the land may be used also a part of the dedication ordinance? If you intend to, then, to make this a part of the subdivision requirements or conditions under which the land is accepted, or what?
Well, I asked the attorney his question again. I'll try to look for it. You can't make a dedication by the filing of a simple filing of a subdivision map. Am I wrong or right?
You can offer to dedicate, and
well, that's what I ask you. Can you make a dedication by the filing of a subdivision map? That's what
you're
fighting.
You can.
What's the meaning on me? How do you do it?
The subdivision map designates a certain parcel of property as park property. If that map is accepted by the city by its resolution, then in effect becomes that acceptance of the dedication.
But a designation, not a dedication.
That's right.
Because you can amend your subdivision map at a later time and take the park right out, subdivide it, and have a new map. And
if you approve it, yes. And then it doesn't fall within your traditional charter section as far as dedication. But
the mayor is saying is that if we have the power by the council alone to amend something ourselves and take it out of being a park, then we're not required to go to a vote of the people on, as we do now, on any dedicated park. Every dedicated park requires a 2/3 vote of the majority of the people.
There's two definitions of dedication of parks. One is the 2/3 allowable by the voter, and the other one isn't. And what you're saying is that it won't be within the standards of a dedicated park that Frank is talking, whereby you have to have 2/3 vote to change the park.
No,
so the answer is no then.
Isn't it really dedication and designation?
Designation, yeah. I think that's really
Well, if you're talking about dedication in terms of the charter.
You're talking dedication in terms of the charter.
Then the position the attorney's office is taking consistently here is that those words are used with particularity. You have to dedicate by ordinance in perpetuity. The mere acceptance of a subdivision map by your resolution does not fall within that particular category, so you're not subjecting the land to the 2/3 vote. But it still is, for purposes of the map, at that particular time, it is dedicated to park use, but it does not fall within the charter.
Well, designated for park use.
Let's clear something up. Maybe we need a definition of dedication on this thing if it's that confusing, because when we're working on a policy on dedication of parks, I assume, and frankly, that's the way I look at it, was that we're dedicating parks like Mission Bay Park or Balboa Park, and this is the policy on whether we dedicate parks of a certain size and development. Is this the way that you people went through it?
Well, yeah. The attorney has me confused. When you file a subdivision map, within that map, you dedicate your streets, don't you?
No, they're accepted by dedication after.
Yeah, all right. But now at the same time, it is the intent here that you will accept the dedication of certain land for park purposes under the same conditions. You don't have any trouble with your streets now.
Yeah, but we can vacate a street ourselves by council action, whereas we can't vacate a park that's dedicated to
right.
the council. Land.
Now, what we provided here is that these will be handled on an individual basis. It doesn't preclude it. It says if no restrictions exist against disposal, the land will be considered for dedication by ordinance if it meets the criteria of paragraph 1. We have not closed the door. We're trying to cover here the conditions under which the city gets the land. But now, what we're trying to say is, let's consider each item on its own individual basis in relation to the criteria set forth in paragraph 1, is really all we're saying here.
Well,
this is what we think would be the wise thing to do.
Oh, well, we start talking about a council policy, and that council policy, the purpose is to establish the policy of the dedication of park lands. Now, that's pretty simple, and I think we should know what we're talking about now. We're talking about delineation or dedication as you would a street as against dedication as you would a park.
No.
I think this should be very clear if this is to be the guideline.
We're talking about dedication of land to where it requires a two-thirds vote of the people to change its use.
Well, then dedication is used by in two different meanings here, because on the second page in the third line of section 2, this is a dedication that the council can change without a vote of the people. Therefore, it is not
that
type of dedication. It's the heading of the policy.
That should be designation.
Designation, right.
That is the wrong word there.
If that were changed to designation, it would be consistent with...
Let's change the word to dedication, to designation instead of dedication, and then I'll still ask the question. If the conditions of the designation by subdivision are such that the land may not be disposed of without a vote of the people, how do you do this on a subdivision?
Well, I suppose, and I'm not too sure exactly what the meaning was on this, but you could suppose that the offer within the subdivision map itself would indicate that the grant, when given to the city, would indicate within itself that there should be a vote of the people before it could change.
But how can you get a subdivision map with conditions on it that you can't dispose of land without a vote of the people? That's not within the scope of the subdivision. Unless I certainly don't understand subdivisions,
we can change them.
You mean the assignment of the property to the city, these restrictions would be in that assignment?
Mm-hmm. The assignment could be within the grant itself.
Well, then that would be over and above the subdivision requirements.
Well, why couldn't the purpose be to establish the policy for dedication of parkland and to establish a policy of designation of parklands for possible future dedication or something of that nature? This brings out both of the points very clearly that you understood them. Because the way it is, you start out with a thing here, and then I would hate to think that we were sitting adopting subdivision maps and we're dedicating parks at the same time. Well, first of all, I challenge the attorney that we can't. Subdivision law doesn't provide for it.
Well, of course we can't. They're only adopted by resolution and
separate
individuals. We have a right to change
it. Well, Mr. Merritt, the problem that is faced here is you have what is on the books now in the new addition to the Subdivision Map Act, which states that the governing body of a city or county may by ordinance require the dedication of land, the payment of fees in lieu thereof, or a combination of both, for park or recreation purposes as a condition to the approval of a final subdivision map.
That's two separate instruments you're talking about. But that isn't what this says. This says that if the conditions of the subdivision are such, and it can't be.
No, it's the conditions of the designation by subdivision.
Yeah.
Right. The designation, which could be your grant, could be your deed restrictions. It would not be in what you consider your normal subdivision papers. This is a separate instrument, which is your designation. Now, that could be, the wording of that could be a restriction sufficient to constitute your designation. But that's up to you to negotiate at the time, as I see it. It is not really a part of your subdivision acceptance.
Why not?
Why not?
Mr. Parks?
Yeah. This was written in and due to an opinion by Ellen Firestone about 3 or 4 years ago, and when we listed a number of parks, she wanted to know whether or not they were designated or whether the city could dispose of them. Some of these parks were accepted by subdivision, and his opinion was, in certain cases, that the city had by affirmative action accepted these parks, and consequently they could not be disposed of without a vote of the people. Now, this paragraph was written to cover those instances. There are other instances where he said the city did not accept it, the council didn't, by affirmative action, accept this piece of land. Consequently, these parks were not designated. we're not dedicated. Our word could be spoken.
I didn't think the simplest way to do it is just have the policy on dedication of park lands and just say that all park lands that will be dedicated, defined dedicated as those parks that require for disposal by the city of 2/3 vote of the electorate will be done by ordinance, period. Just do them all by ordinance that have to be done. I mean,
they have to be anyway.
So, I mean...
Well, we would clarify it, certainly. There wouldn't be any ambiguity. Now, and again, I would... I hate to do this, but I would challenge what you just said about Alan Firestone. I don't believe that it's possible to pass or in the future to ever, to ever accept a dedication by subdivision.
Get the attorney.
I guess you
have some problems on that one.
Yeah.
Well, I find that attorneys' opinions they end up finally, if they're tested, that they're either right or they're wrong. I mean, just because they are let out doesn't mean that they're it.
Usually, an attorney on each side,
and one of them 50% wrong most of the time.
No, half the time.
Half the time.
I said 50%
wrong most of the time.
All of the
time. I see. I'm sorry. I was conservative.
Mayor,
the reason there is an extra dedicated land is for the sure the property owners in the area that this will always remain a park without 2/3 vote of the city, or is it we don't have confidence in the action of some future council may want to make it a cemetery?
I think there are more problems than that. One is that periodically we have offers of land for parks, and we may or may not want to accept them, and certain conditions are being established here to prevent us from just getting a whole bunch of commitments for future land development we may or may not want.
Parks can be white elephants, Mike. They can break.
We limit ourselves to a lot of upkeep for forever.
Yeah. A lot of other problems. We got that one down there in Golden Hill. What's the name of it? Grant Park. Another source of trouble ever since it was dedicated to the city. We haven't been able to do anything, Mike. Or,
assume that you meet all the conditions of that they have set, or the criteria they have set here. How is the thing kicked off? How do we
initiate
the action of the ordinance? Can it be by petition, or by, does it have to be affirmative action of the council to bring it up, or what?
They're the only ones who can adopt an ordinance. But
I think you better read Section 55 first. Now, this is your law, as I understand it. Section 55 says in here that real property owned and fee by the city, heretofore or hereafter formally dedicated in perpetuity by ordinance of the council. Now, that's the way you get a park, is by ordinance of the council. There's no other way, am I right, Attorney?
No, he doesn't agree with
you. Well, he says no.
The only way you get a dedicated park.
Dedicated park is by ordinance.
This is the only way you get a dedicated park which is subject to a 2/3 vote of the people for disposal.
That's all I'm asking about. Okay. Therefore, the only way to get a dedicated park which requires 2/3 of the vote of the people to dispose of is by ordinance. Right? Now, all the this then says, in essence, for the city council to consider such an ordinance and pass such an ordinance, the criteria set forth in paragraph 1 should be met. Now, how it is initiated, personally, we like to see it initiated either by the Park and Recreation Board or by individuals. Normally, it's always by individuals who can initiate it by application to the Park Board. There's no formal set procedure. We have requests now from the Claremont area for dedication of certain lands up there as park land. Frankly, we've accepted the request, but first we said let's adopt a policy which is applicable to the city as a whole, rather than considering these criteria in one area. Let's have the council adopt the policy. The park board would then consider its recommendation to the city council within the bounds of the general policy which you established, paragraph 1. Now, paragraphs 2 and 3 merely cover subdivisions or gifts or grants by saying that if land is obtained by the city in such a way that it is restricted, without specifying how, that perhaps an ordinance isn't necessary. Now, if the council feels an ordinance is necessary or advisable, as far as we're concerned, we'll recommend an ordinance. Perfectly all right. All we're trying to do here is to get the basic policy under which land will become parkland and subject to 2/3 vote of the people. That's all we want to get enforced. So then we have something to act on. Helen's got some problems
not problems, but requests, I think, in areas. All of you are going to have them.
Well, that, I realize what all you said here is how you go about it. But to get it before the park board, can one citizen write a letter in and say, please consider this, or would you have to consider it, or would by petition of 10% of the people around this area have to do it, or would the council itself have to initiate the action, assuming that you met the criteria?
Well, just as an example, this board would be able to see real readily. Kerry Mesa,
right.
Winburn came to me.
Right.
He said, we'd like to get the park designated. I called the Park and Rec department, and they said, yes, that's going to be a park forever, 74 acres. And they came up with the map, and they prepared the ordinance to put it on the docket, and we approved it.
Not dedicated.
I mean, dedicated.
But would you have had to consider that request in any way?
Well, I think with the formation, with the reorganization and the formation of the Park and Recreation Board, all of these requests would be reviewed by them for recommendation first. If we're going to have a master plan of parks and development,
one of our problems now is we don't turn down anybody's request, whether it's an individual or anybody. It takes time. But one individual could come to us and say, I want 5 acres over here as a park. We'll take the time to determine whether it's advisable to go ahead. We may say after review. We won't say offhand, well, you get 50,000 people and we'll do it. Answer to your specific question, yes, one person can initiate action. There is no formality as far as we're concerned.
What your advice would... I'm not so concerned about what they can, it's whether they shall or may take a provision. let's assume that the park board did not recommend. It would never come up then, theoretically.
Possibly.
That'd be the end of it.
No. Well, you can bring it directly to us.
You can put an ordinance on it.
You can
have
them
directly to us by
initiative.
No, we can put it on ourselves.
Yeah. Or they can come to us.
I realize that.
They can
come
to council. We refer
to
the park
board. To put it on the thing.
So they can bring it directly to us.
Sure, they can come to us in the form of a communication on the council docket.
And they will.
And we either refer to the park board, or well, there's many things we can do.
I would say, or you refer to the park board treaty.
Well, future councils will
establish these criteria. I would expect that staff itself would initiate these as they become eligible.
Planning department, planning staff, in the development of Liberty Master. There are going to be a lot of ways that they're going to be reaching. And some of our organizations like Peninsulans Inc. and La Jolla and so on, in along with their studies, will come up with the realization that in order to complete their plan, there should be a certain area which is not now dedicated. It should be dedicated. What problem would we really incur if we should term these as dedicated parks, and if it comes to a point of disposal, no longer in need?
2/3 vote.
Is that really a great problem? I know it has to go on the ballot, but as time goes on, is that a great problem?
What?
To put these things on the ballot?
Yeah, we could.
Give this opinion of the, say, the right department that this park is no longer in.
I think
in
it's going to be less and less of a problem in the long run, but I can think of one right now that we've had trouble with all the time, and then get back to Old Grant Park. That half block down there on 24th and G, 26th and G. We tried to put that on the ballot a couple times.
Stop
and good. Little concerted effort in the community down there, but it'll never be developed, I don't think.
Let me ask a general question. I think Tom had his answer. We have a lot of areas in the city of 1, 2 acres, a half an acre, areas which we consider not accessible as parks under today's criteria. Now, we're in no position to consider these for exchange. It may be possible, for instance, to dispose of a half acre or an acre park and obtain 5 acres. To do this, we have to put it on the ballot for the vote of the people. Now, what we say is this. Leave the actual designation to the point where we say this is going to be a park, and we are prepared to have a plan drawn. The plan is drawn, and the development has been scheduled. At that point, freeze it.
no one can change it. Up to that point, leave the flexibility in the city to draw all the parks in to the proper park system. Now, this is basically what, again, what we're asking for.
Dedicated park land.
Dedicated to time, it definitely is going to become a park.
Yes, at a later date.
Well, is this a safe thing to say then? The purpose is to establish a policy for the dedication of park lands by ordinance requiring a two-thirds electorate vote for disposal, and to designate other lands for park use which would not be subject to the voter approval for disposal. Is that what we're talking about?
No.
Well, I'm trying to find out really what we're doing. And as the purpose doesn't explain it, I don't know what will.
To establish a policy for the dedication of parkland.
By ordinance requiring two-thirds vote, electric vote for disposal.
Okay.
And also to designate other lands for park use which would not be subject to voter approval for disposal. We're not going to have any lands, as this says, that we're not going to have any lands that will be used for park use that will not be frozen by the electorate or Section 55.
I would hope that's not true.
Well, that's the point I'm getting at, and that's the way I understand it, as what we have been shooting for all the time. In short, you're going to have lands that you want there forever. There are other lands which may or may not be required, but we don't want to take and get these white elephants hooked in here where we can't get rid of them. Something may look like a beautiful park today, and if it does not fulfill the criteria, or the subdivision map is not complete, as it were, and you don't want the park. No, that's the thing I'm trying to find out.
Simply, this is a policy on dedication of parks, and what it says is that the policy for dedication will be by ordinance. And then the further explanation goes down, not talking about designation or anything, but it says that in cases where it's by deed restriction or subdivision or whatever it may be that accomplishes the same thing as a dedication by ordinance, it won't be necessary to dedicate it by ordinance, period. It's not talking about designations. It doesn't get into the designation policy.
Okay.
I think, if I could comment on this, I think the key to this whole thing is C, where you say that it won't be dedicated except if it's on the 6-year program. And I think this is a good proposal because there's parks we're dealing with right now that have been there for 25 years that have never been developed and never been on the 6-year capital program, and to the point right now where we're looking at exchanging it for a park that will better serve, maybe 500 yards away, better serve the entire community and so on. And the reason it hasn't been dedicated is because it never had gotten to the point on the 6-year capital program. And I don't think we should dedicate things that aren't going to be developed within at least 6 years because too many things change. And I think that is probably the key to the dedication.
No, in just an answer to Harry's statement, I think Jack is part of it. Our problem is not designation. In fact, if anything, we have too much of that. The problem is in separating these out for a dedication.
Okay, well, let's get back to number two then. Oh, excuse me.
Well, I think we should have some policy on freezing some of the land, even though it's not within the 6-year designation, perhaps not freezing it to the extent that it's in perpetuity, but still having retaining the flexibility to freeze it for, say, a 10-year period, not to the extent of perpetuity, but say 10, 15, 20 years, whatever we're looking at in terms of some long-range plans where it cannot be taken out and simply sold on the spur of a moment because we think we got some other type of deal.
Maybe
bring an enlightenment on this. How much land in the last 10 years that was designated for parks has been sold or exchanged as surplus property?
Half a dozen canyons we haven't got rid of yet.
Well, no, that have been designated as a neighborhood park. I don't recall of one.
I can think of where we've taken a sliver for a road expansion or right of way.
We can do that in a dedicated park.
Yeah.
But he said actually dispose of.
I know one of
them has been getting disposal of for years, but they have never done it. I don't think it's dedicated. I hope not.
We've got a complete inventory of these, incidentally.
Can you answer
that? We have a report for that.
Have they been disposed of?
Yeah, I don't recall any. I know what Floyd's worry is, and but maybe maybe it's something that is that hasn't happened to the great extent.
The sale or exchange of any land requires council action to begin with. I mean, it's
the reason right. that this ordinance is before us is because the reverse is true rather than what you're fearful of. We're getting overburdened with
well,
offers.
That may be true at the moment, but in the future, it may not.
Well, now, correct me on this if I'm wrong. It, this dedication of the park does more than just keep it in perpetuity. It establishes a particular use.
So limited use.
So that on some of the others now, I can think of one right offhand that is designated as park. It's never been dedicated. It's just been reserved that is the farthest thing in the world from a park. It's just completely used by commercial enterprise. So when, don't take, you know, what I'm talking about. Where the old amusement center is.
Belmont Park.
But, is this not correct that it does more than keep it for duty? It completely limits its use to park and restaurants?
Well, we got into discussions on Mission Bay many years ago. That's where the council first got concerned about dedication.
Mission Bay was never dedicated for a long time.
Yeah, that's right. And at that time, it was the attitude of the council that the less dedication, the better off we were because of the flexibility. And that was the policy we pursued for a while. I don't know whatever happened to it. But in Mission Bay right now, we have dedication in the central part, which is creating some problems. We do not have dedication of part of it, which is still dedicated to the same use, which is the Sausage Channel. We have a combination of dedication is not a blessing. Yes, and dedication is not a blessing. Believe me.
That's why you're so high.
I'm looking at something here, and I'm still concerned about getting a park dedicated without ordinance. And I'm looking at this, still looking at this section 2, on page 2. And if I read this right, if the conditions of, and changing the word even to designation, if the conditions of the designation by subdivision are such that the land may not be disposed of without a vote of the people, dedication by ordinance is unnecessary. Well, this would indicate to me that it is possible to tie the property up for a two-thirds vote of the people without an ordinance.
And I say they can't.
Well, the point is...
The attorney just said you can't, too.
Well, but the point is it's still here. Now, what are we going to do with this? Is this coming out of this section?
I say take out the whole section on 2. Make 3-2.
Well, okay. All right. Now, with this, let's work on the assumption you're going to take out 2.
But just
what effect does this have?
Take the first sentence. Park sites designated and accepted by subdivision must be considered on an individual basis, period.
What? Yeah. Okay.
That's right.
All right.
Planning and park department.
Okay.
Park board.
And
well, this starts to get down to where I can understand it. If that is coming out, now is that what's going to happen?
Well, why don't you just do this? Park sites designated and accepted by subdivision must. Park sites acquired by gift or grant will be considered on an individual basis, and then it will read through the same way.
Well, this is fine. Now, is there any objection to doing that? There must be reasons why.
Yeah, I think you're if you want to do that, why don't you go back to paragraph 1 in the opening sentence. Park sites acquired by purchase, by designation, by subdivision map, or gift or grant will be recommended for dedication by ordinance when the following criteria are met. Why don't you roll everything in one ball of wax? You
want to
do that. That's
well,
it.
Well, does that make sense?
Yeah,
it
does
make sense.
Well, I thought it did.
What you're saying is these four criteria are what will govern anything
right.
becoming a dedicated
right.
park, is what
right.
you're saying.
Right.
Okay.
So we're taking out section 2?
No, I think that's right. Park sites acquired by the city in any manner will be.
By any manner, what it means. Mm-hmm.
So we take out section 2.
Two and three.
Well, and how about this other section down here, or on section 3, we've got a piece of that,
that's
too. That's
coming out.
That's coming out, too.
Oh, all
and 3. Okay.
Now, Mr. Mayor, I think to answer Mr. Scheidel's statement, under purpose, you could put in there, to establish a policy for the dedication of parks in accordance with section 55 of the city charter, you put in there all two-thirds vote.
Yeah.
If you want to refer to the city charter, that's it. That covers it.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Your Honor, I asked Judge when I was over there for a cup of coffee whether or not he was a designated park commissioner or a dedicated park commissioner.
Well, this is what's happening in the month of December. I guess I'm dedicated or something.
No, he's both. He's designated and he's dedicated.
No, I refuse to be dedicated because I don't want the vote of the people to...
Actually,
you don't want to be dedicated. Two-thirds vote of the people, get rid of Doug Kidding.
Actually, he's neither one. He's federated.
That's a nasty word.
Could we ask the park board to come back with also a interim freezing type of proposal, one that would, where we look at it in the sense that we would plan to have a park in an area, but we could freeze it for 10, 15, 20 years.
I think we do
something
that
of this nature, where we know where we're going, and that we're not going to take just action of expediency.
Yes, we have a master plan of park development.
Still doesn't restrict you from, if the occasion arose, to take expedient action and simply get rid of some property that perhaps is a very well suited for the purpose.
You're going to put a 10-year freeze on a piece of property, that'd be against that.
Especially with my party plaza.
There's a lot of, I think, objection to that right off the top, is that these opportunities for exchange and where we can really get a tremendous park by come pretty fast. And if you have a piece of property with a freeze on it, and an opportunity comes along,
well, part of your freeze policy could be that it could be exchanged for park land. That would be
a kind of a freeze.
No.
You've got to have more faith in the department.
Instead of with loopholes, I think our present system has been working well, and to tie our hands,
that's exactly what I want to do, is tie our hands to the point that we don't, by expediency, simply go boom.
I think
the park's department come back with a report on just how many lands designated for parks in the last 10 years have been sold or traded. You know, give us an idea of, do you have it now?
No, we'll pull it together with that.
And give us the location. We may not be talking about it.
Perhaps the council would also be interested in seeing